Okay, well, here we go. Welcome to what I'm calling a first course in applied mathematics. And welcome to the matrix. No, seriously, here is indeed what you will recognize as a matrix. These are very important in applied mathematics. And of course, you'd have seen matrices before if you're taking an undergraduate course in pretty much any science, a linear algebra, very fundamental subject when you study matrices. So here's one. So what do we observe about it? Let's make some observations. First thing I noticed, by the way, is it's not square. I remember when I was young, all of the matrices I saw, the simplest ones, 2 by 2, 3 by 3 matrices, you know, you learn how to invert them, all kinds of different things. And this one's not square because it doesn't have the same number as of columns as it does rows. And in fact, if we use m to be the number of rows, you can clearly see this is 5 rows. And if we use n to denote the number of columns, it's got 4 columns, okay? Just count. You can see that four columns, 5 rows. So this is what we call an m by n matrix. And it's not square. What else? Well, I noticed, by the way, there are no sevens, are there? I can't see any sevens or anything else. So just see plus or minus ones and zeros. So the elements are just plus or minus one and zero. That's not usual for a matrix. So this is clearly a special matrix. What other things do you learn about in a linear algebra course? Well, you remember the word rank? What's the rank of the matrix? Well, I remember that the rank of a matrix was the rank was defined, if we call this matrix A, shall we? The rank of A was defined to be the dimension of the column space. Okay, the dimension of the column space. In other words, the dimension of the space spanned by the columns. And actually, there's something called if you're certainly an undergraduate in mathematics, you would learn something called the rank nullity theorem, which tells you the remarkable fact that the rank of A is also equal to, who knew, it's the dimension of the row space. Okay, so the rank nullity theorem is precisely the result that actually the dimensions of these two spaces, so the dimension of the five-dimensional space spanned by the columns, because they all sit in they're all five-dimensional vectors, and the space spanned by the four-dimensional row space is the same. That's got the same dimensions. Of course, they're not the same spaces, but they have the same dimensions. Okay, well, let's have a look at this matrix then. So I'm going to make an observation. Have you noticed something about it? Because it's just ones and zeros, it's quite obvious to notice that if I introduce this vector of just ones, I'm going to call it x naught. You notice anything about that? Well, as I said, we're going to call this A. So I've noticed that if you just work out A operating on x naught, so you can clearly see that I can, you know, put 1, 1, 1, 1 here and do the matrix multiplication. And you can see that, remember, what you do is you put these elements of the matrix, of the vector, over the columns of the matrix and drop it down, okay? And then you add up, basically, all of the sum of the elements in each row. And you can clearly see that because there's a plus 1 and a minus 1 and then just zeros in each row, that this gives 0. And of course, it gives a five-dimensional 0 vector because the vector, the matrix is 5 by 4, m by n. Okay, and what we say actually is in linear algebra, you learn that x naught is in the right null space. Okay? And why do I call it a right null space? Well, it's quite a nice name actually. Well, first of all, if you notice, here's A, and X is on the right. Okay, so I'm operating with A and putting X on the right, but look at this. I get nothing. This is null. nothing, null. So X naught is in the right null space. Very nice name for that. Some people call it, by the way, the kernel of A. Depends what course you took. But they're synonyms for the same thing. And that means the following thing. There's another way to interpret that. Remember, X naught means, another way to write X naught is equal to zero is that the following thing. If we call this A1, A2, A3, A4. So what I'm doing is I'm just giving names to the columns of A. Then this basically means that A1 plus A2 plus A3 plus A4, these vectors, this column vectors, is the zero vector. I'm not going to, by the way, throughout the course, I'm not going to underline zero vectors. I can just rearrange that and say that A4 is this linear combination of A1, 2, and 3. Okay? So in a linear algebra course, you would say that A4 is linearly dependent on the other vectors. Okay? Now, what I've shown there is that not all of the four column vectors are linearly independent. In fact, I can see that the fourth column is that linear combination of the first, second, and third column. So I know that the rank can't be four. Okay, but I wonder if it's at least three, though. Well, if it's going to be three, it means that so we now ask, are A1, A2, and A3 linearly independent? Forgive my spelling. You know what I mean. Well, remember what you do in a linear algebra course. If you're asked that question, what you do is you introduce some coefficients. C1 will be the coefficient of A1. You don't underline those. C2 and A2 and C3, A3 is zero. You ask yourself, if a linear combination with some coefficients C1, C2, C3 is zero, then what are C1, C2, C3? And you conclude that these are linear independent vectors if all of the C1, C2, C3 are all zero. Well, let's just write these down. Look, this is 0, minus 1, 0, 0. I'm just looking at the matrix to read these off. C2 is then 1, minus 1, 0, 0, 1. And then C3 is 0, 1, 0, 1, 0. Okay? And we want that to be equal to 0. And can't you see that? So in other words, and let's just be precise about that. When I say 0, I mean it has to be the 0 vector. Okay? And I think you can see, can't you, just by looking at the last two rows, that if you look at this, look, we've got a zero there, a one there, and a zero there. So that means that C2 has to be zero, okay? And then this the penultimate line, you've got a zero here, you've got a zero there, but you've got a one there. So that means that that has to be zero, okay? And consequently, you can conclude actually from the middle row, look, that C1 also has to be zero. Okay, so yes, indeed, what we've concluded then is that these are all zero. And that means that the first, second, and third columns of this matrix are indeed linearly independent. Okay, so therefore, the rank of this matrix, the rank of A is 3. Okay, because it's got three linearly independent non-zero columns in its column space, the fourth one being a linear combination of the first three. Okay, well, we mentioned the rank nullity theorem, didn't we, that said that the rank of A is also the dimension of the row space. And remember that we found this vector x naught that when multiplied on the right of A gives 0. Well, what about, let's ask ourselves this. What are solutions of A transpose W is equal to 0? Okay. A transpose being the transpose of this matrix A. Okay. Well, let's ask about that. Okay, well, let me tidy up my screen here and put the matrix A that we are considering there, and let's put its transpose on the main screen here. So I think you can see, can't you, that this is just A transpose. If you take the transpose of the matrix A underneath me, you'll get this matrix here. Just check. And of course, this one is 4 by 5. It's got 4 rows and 5 columns. It's the transpose. And remember, we're interested in the following, finding solutions W satisfying the following equation. Okay. Well, what about this? Of course, these vectors are going to be 5-dimensional vectors because they've got to multiply, they've got to fit this multiplication here. Okay, so let's just see what happens, look, if we put W1 over here, all right? Or better still, let's put it over the top there and see what happens. And you can, I'll just do the first one for you. Of course, if I multiply these two together, I get -1. If I multiply these two together, I don't get anything. If I multiply these two together, I get +1. And then I don't get anything from those two. So you see, look, that I'm going to get the first 0 there. And if you just, I'll leave you to do the rest of this, you can just check that you get zeros there, okay? So what I conclude from that is that A transpose W1 is indeed 0, okay? What about this one? Clearly, that's not equal to W1. They've got very different components. Well, I'll let you do the calculations. You can easily check that A transpose W2 is equal to 0. Okay, I'll just let you do that calculation. What about this one? Again, doesn't take much to just run those over the top of the matrix here and to find that A transpose W3 is also equal to 0. So that's interesting, isn't it? I've clearly got 3 very different looking vectors that all satisfy this equation here. Well, if I've got an equation like this that I've solved, I notice that I can take a transpose. Okay, let me just take the transpose of it. Well, you take transpose of 0, I'm just going to get another 0. I just write it as another 0 vector. Okay. And we all know how to take transposes, don't we? We reverse the order and take the transpose of everything. And then we know, don't we, that the transpose of a transpose doesn't do anything to the matrix you start with. So we've got a W transpose times A is equal to 0. Okay, let's underline our vectors. So look at this. We have now got this equation in front of us. And I noticed something reminiscent of something earlier, that W now is on the left of A. Can't spell left. Left of A. And on the right hand side, I've got null. I've got nothing. So what do you think we call these vectors W? This W1, W2, and W3, which are all vectors that satisfy this, or equivalently this. They are all elements of the left null space. Okay? Let me just write down W1 and W2 again. And in fact, W3 was this. Well, it doesn't take a genius to notice that W3 is just W1 plus W2. Interesting, just check. Okay. So they're not linearly independent. So they're not linearly independent. W3 is clearly that linear combination of W1 and W2. But I wonder if W2 and W1 are linearly independent. Give myself a little bit more space here. So to answer that question, let's C1 W1 plus C2, I don't need to underline that, C2 W2 equals 0. Equivalently, C1 of 1, 0, minus 1, 0, minus 1, that's W1, plus C2 of 0, 1, 0, minus 1, 1, then you can see, can't you, that if from the first element, look, I get C1 from there, but nothing from there, forcing C1 to be 0. And then in the second element, I get nothing from there, but I get C2, and that's got to be 0. So I get C2 is 0. So I conclude, therefore, that W1 and W2 are linearly independent. Okay, these are two linearly independent vectors in the left null space. Okay, I wonder if there are any more. Remember, I didn't even show you how I got these W1, W2, and W3. I'm going to show you that in the next lecture. But you remember, I showed you before the rank nullity theorem. And previously, we used the part of the rank nullity theorem that tells us that the rank is equal to the dimensions of the column space, which is equal to the dimensions of the row space. There's more than that, though. It tells us actually that the dimensions of the left null space plus the rank of A is equal to M, the number of rows of A. Even more, it tells us that the dimension of the right null space plus the rank of A is equal to, guess what, N, the number of columns of A. Okay, so let's just look at this. We know the rank of A is 3. We know M is 5, and we know N is 4. So how does all this weigh up with what we've just discovered? Well, this statement here then tells us that the dimension of the left null space is 2. And we've just found W1 and W2, which are non-zero linearly independent elements of the left null space. So we're done. There are no more to find, and moreover, we have a linearly independent basis. This one, by the way, the second one here, just before we finish this lecture, tells us that the dimension of the right null space is indeed 1. But we know that already, remember, because we already know that this 1, 1, 1, 1 vector was the element that sat in the right null space, because remember, we found this before, okay? And that's consistent with this final statement that actually the dimension of the right null space is 1, and we've got a basis of that too. It's just this non-zero vector x naught.